The following program is classified as PG. It is not suitable for viewing by persons under 15 years of age without guidance from a parent or guardian. This is an opinion-based program. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good evening, I'm Mahieash Johnney. It's 7 o'clock and this is the State of the Nation.
Tonight, it's King Vijay's fault. Former Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe deflects taking any responsibility when pointed out that his government's erroneous policies left Sri Lanka unsecure.
දුර්වල මට්ටම නිසා එම පීඩන වල අයහපත් බලපෑම් ඊටත් වඩා දරුණු වී තිබෙනවා.
මේක අන්තිමට ඉවර වෙන්නේ විජය රජුරෝනේ. එයා ලංකාවට ඇවිල්ලා ආවේ නැත්තම් මේ ප්‍රශ්නේ තියෙන්නේ නැහැ කියලා.
However, the president is sympathetic and calls for unity to solve Sri Lanka's current problems.
මේක දේශපාලනික කාරණයක් නෙවෙයි. සෑම දෙනාගේම අදහස් ගන්නට තමයි කතා කරන්නේ.
17 times the charm. Sri Lanka's economy is getting hammered from each and every side.
Why is it yano metanam tel ganna vi?
Maha unta meva therenna.
Jeevath wen vidiyakut naha, kannak naha.
The liberal clan says it's because we haven't sought help from the IMF.
Monowata dehena metthira kal bala gane hiti.
Man hitanne pramanavat madi attarama.
However, in certain instances, sanity prevails.
Peter ඒ සම්බන්ධ කරන්න ඕනේ නැහැ අපේ ආර්ථික අර්බුද මේ මේ විසඳීමට
අපිට දැන් තියෙන එකම විසඳුම රටේ සම්පත් තුල තමයි මේ ප්‍රශ්නෙට උත්තර හොයාගන්න පුළුවන්.
Can Sri Lanka use this opportunity to find a proper solution that will last a lifetime and forgetting our friends? Despite Sri Lanka's inability to seek support to its current problems from countries that have stood by this nation since time immemorial,
China is having $3,400 billion in their foreign currency reserves.
Why is the government more hell-bent on resorting to action that has failed us? Is this a prudent way to go? That and much more next on State of the Nation.
It's Sunday, March 27, 2022. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the State of the Nation, where we invite you to know your nation, to know the world. Well, tonight, our focus is all about Sri Lanka's economy. We will show you why the current liberal decision to seek the support of the IMF is the wrong one and how it will impact in the long term for our country. But first, people are literally dropping dead when standing in queues for fuel. People are being stabbed to death, literally, when trying to get their essentials. Where are the solutions? Where are the answers? If by any chance the leaders cannot fathom a tangible solution or needs time to cough one up, then where is the empathy for the people and their suffering? Every minister in the government, every parliamentarian, every politician, when they come out to go anywhere, they have their vehicle brought into the entrance. They don't have to figure out from where the fuel is coming, who got it for them. The car is fueled up and ready to go. Heck, they don't even have to care about the prices.
Then diesel ki yet?
Adada. Adavena kota ada.
Oh.
Adavena kota.
When our politicians go to any place for any meeting and comes back home and switches on the light, well, the light will switch on for sure. No power cut for them. Either the generator will kick in to power or solar panels will do their job. If anything, the power from the national grid will provide them unlimited supply. The politicians don't have to figure out who's going to pay my bill. The ministry will pay it for them. When they go to the kitchen, food is there magically. They don't have to figure out gas prices or where to get gas. Gas is delivered to their homes and they will have food on the table to eat at any time they please. Gas prices were increased in around 2,000 rupees. So it doesn't mean a thing for them. Because fuel is on unlimited supply, because electricity is on demand and gas supply is continuous, is that why caring, empathy, solving problems or giving a damn is in short supply from our dear politicians? Is it why they act like Marie Antoinette? Can't find bread? Let them eat cake. For the people of this country, it's not about the suffering. Our people have undergone severe hardships. We've gone through a fear of being blown into pieces by taking a simple bus ride. I've experienced that firsthand. Well, that didn't stop us from living our lives. We've undergone severe economic hardships before as well. But our leaders' lack of empathy and clarity is a fact that people cannot fathom right now. The failure to give a damn is something that only leads towards change in leadership. This is the same sentiment people had back in 2015. The opportunistic opposition back then was raging bull after bull against former President Mahinda Rajapaksa. The former president remained silent. Didn't come amidst his people to tell the truth, to expose the bull. It cost us everything. The country went back from growth to the depths of hell. Now we are at that precipice again. Mr. President, on November 18, 2019, 6,924,255 Sri Lankan citizens entrusted their lives to your hand, knowing very well that you are not a typical politician. You don't kiss the babies and make small talks. We've seen you try that recently and we appreciate that. But your trying was not why we kept our faith in you. We kept our faith in you is because you had a different vision for this nation, a refreshing vision. Right now, our nation is in distress. Economically, there's doom and gloom on the horizon. People are suffering. Whilst we see you understand the situation, we really don't see any solutions being taken immediately, or better yet, communicating those decisions to your people, or at least an attempt by your end to tell the people your calculated steps and plans to get out of this crisis. We hear a lot of promises, yet we see a dearth of solutions. To meet that doom and gloom, we need a gladiator. In fact, that same gladiator who had enough when our motherland was getting hacked by a worthless, ruthless terrorist called Prabhakaran, and supported a president with all his heart and soul to get rid of it. Instead of talking, that gladiator took matters to his hand, eradicated the terrorists militarily, and succeeded. Our nation right now needs that gladiator. We don't need a baby-kissing, small-talk engaging, diplomatically balancing politician. Right now, we need that gladiator. As our president, at this defining moment in our nation's history, you need to make the tough call and ensure your people, 21 million of them, are safeguarded. No, it's not up to the finance minister, the prime minister, the central bank committee, or any politician. It's not even up to that economic council you've appointed, whose stellar million-dollar brains coughed up the only solution they can. Well, please appoint another committee. The responsibility, Mr. President, is yours and only yours. After all, you are the leader of this nation that 6.9 million chose.
ඒ හැටනම ලක්ෂයේ මිනිස්සුන්ගේ පාරිශුද්ධ අදහසේ තියෙන ආධ්‍යාත්මය කියවන්න බැරි නම් ඒ නායකයාගේ ගැති වැඩේ මොකද්ද? අපේ ජනාධිපතිතුමා ගෝඨාභය මහත්තයා අලුතෙන් පත් වෙච්ච දවසේ පැපිලියන්ට ආවා. පත් වෙලා ආපු වෙලාවේ මම එතුමාට කිව්වා ජනාධිපතිතුමනි අපේ රටේ එක රජ කෙනෙක් හිටියා තමන්ගේ දුව මුහුදට දැම්මා. මම එතන ඉන්න අයගෙන් අහුවා කොයි තාත්තටද පුළුවන් තමන්ගේ දුව මුහුදට දාන්න? හැබැයි ඒ තාත්තා තමන්ගේ දුව මූතට දැම්මේ රට බේරා ගැනීම වෙනුවෙන්. මං කිව්වා ඒ ඉන්න 70 බුරුත්ත මූතට දාන්න කියන්නේ නැහැ. හැබැයි ටිකක් පැත්තකට කරලා තියලා මේ ගමනේ යන්න කියලා. දැන් බැසිල් රාජපක්ෂ කියලා කියන්නේ සහෝදරකමට වැළඳ ගන්න හොඳ චරිතයක් වෙන්නේ නැති ඔබතුමාලට. හැබැයි මේ රටේ ජනතාව මේ චරිතේ වැළඳ ගන්න කැමති නැහැ. ඒ වගේ මේ ක්‍රියාදාමයට කැමති නැහැ. ඒ නිසා මේ ජනතා 69 ලක්ෂයක විතරක් නෙමේ ඡන්දේ දුන්න නොදුන්න ඉපදිච්ච ඉපදෙන්න ඉන්න ඉතිහාසයේ මේ රට රැකගත්තු ජීවිත දුන්න හැම දෙනාම අරමුණු කළේ මේ මව්බිම
21 million Sri Lankans calls this their home. You call this your home. Our home is falling apart, Mr. President. Please fix it. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to the State of the Nation. Let's start with the most significant event of last week, which was to resolve our economic crisis, the all-party conference. The president adhered to this move after former President Maithripala Sirisena requested it. Well, what is the end game of this activity? To find a solution for our economic problems resulting from erroneous policies time and time after. But unfortunately, even right now, we seem to be making a big mistake. We all know what happened at the all-party conference, so I'm not going to keep harping on it. But there was one sensible thing that was said during the whole conference.
මේ ප්‍රශ්නේ කොතනින්ද කෙලවර එන්නේ? මිනිස්සුන්ට දැන් කුසගින්න ප්‍රධාන ප්‍රශ්නයක් කියලා තියෙනවා. කොහොමද අපි මාස 3ක් ඇතුළත දැවැන්ත ජාතික මෙහෙයුමකින් මේ අත්‍යවශ්‍ය ආහාර ටික හොයාගන්නේ? අපිට දැන් තියෙන එකම විසඳුම රටේ සම්පත් තුල තමයි මේ ප්‍රශ්නෙට උත්තර හොයාගන්න.
අපිට ආර්ථික අර්බුදයක් මේ වාගේ දරුණු තත්වයකට මුහුණ දෙනවා නම් එක ලාංකික ජාතියක් හැටියට එක්ව තමයි අපි ඒකට මුහුණ දෙන්න ඕනේ. අපිට පිට ඇය සම්බන්ධ කරන්න ඕනේ නැහැ අපේ ආර්ථික අර්බුද මේ මේ විසඳීමට. අපිට දැනුම ඇති රටේ තත්ත්වය හරියට දන්න අය ලෝකේ තත්ත්වයත් හරියට දන්න ආර්ථික විද්‍යාඥයෝ ඉන්නවා. ඉතින් ඒ අය කරගන්න.
Well, let's get some context into this whole situation. Joining me now is other Derana contributor and political analyst, Malinda Senavaratna. Malinda, appreciate your time. Thank you for being here. Seems like the government is more or less, this time around, trying to solve the problems collectively with other parties. Do you think this will work? Because it hasn't achieved anything substantial in the previous all-party conferences.
Mahesh, there's nothing wrong in a government seeking the opinions of anyone, including the opposition. Ideally, in a democracy, in a parliamentary democracy, that should happen in parliament. But then these kinds of forums are not unusual or like unique, either to Sri Lanka or to elsewhere. Whether they produce any results that are tangible and sort out all our problems, that's left to be seen. Now, there's no legal bind here. Then the opposition doesn't have to attend these things. The Samyuk Jana Balave again, the Janata Vimukti Peramuna, one could say they boycotted. And they may have political reasons to do so, which are not very hard to figure out. Usually, crisis situations feed the opposition, the people who want to come to power, come back to power, regardless of what their track records are. But the signal that is given is, I think, a positive one, which means, of course, the government is not God. The president is not God. Is humble enough to acknowledge that these are problems which need to be discussed in a broader kind of forum. What will come out of it is too early to say, but the initial the news that has come out is not really something that we can cheer. When these discussions happen, they should conclude at some point with a joint statement. You don't pick and choose bits and pieces of what was said. It's almost like someone is playing a game here, and not necessarily the participants at this discussions, but others, and that is of course disappointing.
Indeed, Malinda Senaviratna, the Derana contributor and political analyst, thank you very much. Let's take a short commercial break. On the other side, we'll tell you why the IMF is a wrong move to proceed with. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to the State of the Nation. The silver bullet, the saving grace, the one and only, the Lord and Savior for our current economic crisis, according to the liberal thinking individuals, are, drum roll please.
IMF.
The IMF.
International Monetary Agencies.
The International Monetary Fund, or the IMF. As soon as we go there, we will see the beginning of the renaissance of our economy. Meaning it'll be the beginning of our golden years, right?
According to the data provided on the official website of the International Monetary Fund, Sri Lanka has received assistance from the IMF 16 times, totaling to over 4.4 billion SDRs.
We went to the IMF 16 times and the IMF failed 16 times to fix our economic problems? Is that what you're telling me? So the 17th time is a charm. This is when all the issues pertaining to Sri Lanka's economy will be fixed. Why? Because IMF has come across a magical potion that once we drink the Kool-Aid, voila, everything is fixed. I mean, for a moment, think rationally. If you are sick, you have an issue with your heart, you go to a doctor to get it fixed. You go the first time, no result. The second time, no result. You're still sick, feeling awful, and it doesn't seem like your health is improving whatsoever. What do? Go to someone else to get it fixed, right? You're not going to go to that same person 16 times to the same doctor thinking, oh no, you are my hope. You will ask him to fly a kite and seek assistance at a place where you will get your problems fixed. If that's something we will do regarding our lives, why the heck do we go to an institution that has failed us 16 times? The narrative is not that the IMF is going to fix everything. The actual narrative all these liberal self-proclaimed economic gurus are hiding from you is that the IMF failed 16 times. IMF for Sri Lanka is the ultimate failure for our economic problems. And mind you, when we say that, all those economic pundits will cunningly, shrewdly, will make sure that they put the blame on ourselves, that we couldn't do it. That's why we failed. It's not the IMF. Now, to understand the IMF and why it exists, you need to go back in history and understand the context as why it was created. And during the First and Second World Wars, countries in the West were heavily invested in the military, hoping that their strength and power would win the wars at hand. So what did they do? Well, they put their best resources right at the front of the battle. People. So when over 300 million people were brought into the front lines by their respective governments to fight the war under the guise that if they win the war, prosperity awaits. Now, soon after the world wars ended, many countries were left with a massive number of soldiers and also companies who suddenly found themselves with no purpose. Companies that created war equipment found themselves and their products redundant and with no market to sell. So as the people, they didn't know what else to do, where to turn to. To solve this crisis, countries like the United States took a diligent step to convert these people and companies to production houses that would rebuild their economies. Kellogg's is a good example. During the war, it fed soldiers and soon after converted to a cereal company that produced a breakfast meal. General Motors, another good example. GM was a company that made weapons and armed vehicles during the war. Soon after, bang, converted to an automaker that produces cars for everyday use. And also Lockheed Martin, the company that had missiles and aircrafts for the war, started to switch to passenger aircraft and combat aircraft once the war ended. The American government achieved this by providing these companies with government subsidies during the wartime, hoping to provide America with ways and means to win the war, basically becoming super companies with optimal output. With this switch, these companies were producing at a record pace within a few years. They managed to capture the whole of their American market, meaning they had met the demand domestically. Now, as the production market grew in America, American businesses found that, they were producing higher than the demand, resulting in a massive surplus. Now, the American government had to figure out where the surplus would go. Only several Western countries wanted what America was producing, and they too were doing the same thing. So those markets were not much of a use for America. America wanted new markets around the world to access to sell their products. This is where the idea for organizations like the World Bank and the IMF came to life. Initially, it was called the Bretton Woods Institutions. The Bretton Woods Institutions are a combination of the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund. They were combined. That's how it was created. They were set up at a meeting of 43 countries in Bretton Woods, New Hampshire, in the USA in July of 1944. The Second World War ended somewhere around 1945. The aim was to help rebuild shattered post-war economy and promote international economic cooperation. That is very vital here. In translation, they were tasked with going and finding new markets around the world and making them accessible for American products. Now, this has been going on for some time, and America, by ways and means of politics, economically, financially, and in some instances militarily, captured the world markets little by little. The ones that mattered to them, they kept them under their thumb, and those who didn't, discarded to the dumps. Now in comes China, Russia, doing their own little thing, little by little capturing markets that were vulnerable, valuable to America and becoming a threat to their businesses, their way of life. The best joke about this is that China and Russia is now using the same ethos, rules, regulations, and measures set forth by the United States of America. They are winning the game on America's own turf. This is where the economic Cold War between the United States, China, and Russia comes to play. Sri Lanka too fell for this in 1977 with President J.R. Jayawardena opening Sri Lanka's economy. This garnered him a state visit to the United States of America. I think that is the only state visit by a Sri Lankan leader thus far. Former US President Ronald Reagan hailed him as a true friend. Why? Well, we opened our economy to cater to the needs of America, thus becoming another part of the Western world.
And a country which the United States is proud to count among its friends. Mr. President and Mrs. Jayawardena, welcome to America. I believe your people and their children will reap rewards for many years to come, thanks to the bold economic steps that you've taken.
Now, Sri Lanka is open for America to take a dump anytime they please. In comes the Rajapaksa government in 2005. President Mahinda Rajapaksa had a different vision for this nation. He was tired of being an import-dependent economy. So slowly but surely, he started to put the building blocks of transforming our import-oriented economy into a production-based economy so we could take control of our country's narrative rather than be a pawn in the global economic warfare. We saw President Mahinda Rajapaksa retaking certain national assets that were privatized back into the government's portfolio. That's why we saw the president taking steps to tell no to the IMF program and started to apply homegrown solutions. I know, homegrown solutions are kryptonite to individuals like Dr. Harsha De Silva. Even the former central bank deputy governor, Nandalal Weerasinghe, and a whole plethora of other liberal economists in Sri Lanka. They can't come up with anything. The Sri Lankans. We are slaves. How dare they think? We should just be loyal to our masters out there in the West and kiss their feet and make sure we continue to be loyal slaves. I wonder what kind of pep talk these individuals give their own children. Anyhow, getting back to the whole story, we were doing pretty good. Our solutions were paying dividends and things were on track. President Mahinda Rajapaksa aligned our allegiance to China and India. After all, they are the success stories in our part of the world. And if by any chance we want to stand on our own 2 feet, we got to look at what our own neighbors did and do the same thing. So naturally, this rang alarm bells in America and the West. A slave is attempting to rise. But Mahesh, if you are saying that the US wants to dominate Sri Lanka and the Sri Lankan market and not allow China to infiltrate, then from the onset, we should have big American businesses here in Sri Lanka. But our biggest importers are China and India. So your argument doesn't make sense, right? Well, the thing is this. Of course, the Sri Lankan market is a sad joke for America and the West. Our buying power is pathetic. Our market share is pathetic. And everything is minuscule. Even our brains are at sometimes. But it's not about the market share that America is worried about here in Sri Lanka. There's a global war on trade and commerce, politics and everything between China, America and Russia. All three giants want to be the global leader as per predictions by many think tanks. Now, global pundits are also calling, along with all the jack of all trades, that China will overtake America as the superpower in the world in the near future. Now, how can you be a superpower when you don't have the most amount of countries bowing and worshipping to you? That's where Sri Lanka, the slave, comes in. We all know that the United States of America, under former President Barack Obama, his then Vice President and current clueless leader of the free world, Joe Biden, and supported by a colossally failed presidential candidate, Hillary Clinton, played a pivotal role in getting rid of President Mahinda Rajapaksa by fueling fake allegations and animosity amidst Sri Lankans through their liberal agents in Sri Lanka, like the UNP, mainly because President Mahinda Rajapaksa was getting Sri Lanka to stand in our own 2 feet politically and economically, even militarily. We were a nation that defeated terrorists and proved the West wrong. We were a nation that was taking our economy back, despite doom and gloom predicted by organizations like the IMF and the World Bank. We were a nation that was trying to take control of our narrative, and that, my friend, cannot happen at any cost for America and the rest of the West. Because if one slave gets up, the rest will follow suit. And anarchy will occur. In the end, America will no longer have their dominance over anything. That needs to be stopped at any cost. So they got rid of President Mahinda Rajapaksa and installed the clown of all presidents, Maithripala Sirisena, who brought the Western drums back into Sri Lanka and started to bang them just the way they wanted. Such organizations like the IMF, which failed 15 times prior, came back to give advice for the 16th time under the Yahapalian joke from 2016 to 2019 and started to steer the economy back to the depths and beyond. From a growth of around 5.5% in 2015 to less than 3% in 2019. Who were the traitors of that genius plan to make our country once again fall flat on our face and worship the Western masters? Well, individuals like former Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe, Dr. Harsha De Silva, Iran Vikramaratna, later Minister Mangala Samarabhiwa, and the so-called economic gurus, all of them calculated and came and did what they had to do. They are the ones that have been pushing for this. If you look at all their YouTube videos, interviews, and any forum they speak, some are very tactful to say directly that they are not alluding to asking the Sri Lanka to go to IMF. But that's exactly what they're saying. We even heard that one such individual gave his opinion directly to the finance minister. Indeed, Sri Lanka will again fall flat on our face if we look at the IMF as our Lord and Savior. And when they do, the same thing that happened to the Yahapalaya government at the end of 2019 will occur. This government will too have to pack up their bags and go home. Joining me now from the data wall is our own Danidu Tanavasam. You've studied the IMF recommendations, Danidu, from the last time they were here, from I think 2016 to 2019. You've learned that how their projections and consultations resulted in a destructive path of our economy. We were forced to take that path. Is that a correct sentiment, Danidu?
Yes, Mahesh, that sentiment is very much correct. And we are going to look at a few metrics as to why we say that, because the facts seem to be depicting a different picture when looking at the general IMF conversation. We are going to look at a few key areas. Now, we would expect when the IMF was there within Sri Lanka, which is what happened during the Yahapalne time period, that the reserve situation would have arisen, because reserves is a much token of topic these days. But the blue line represents where IMF thought the reserve situation within the country would have gone to. But this, the line below, is where it actually was. Now, taking the same sentiment forward, the debt situation. Mahesh, you have covered this very much within this program as well. The debt almost doubled during the Yahapalne time period. We see that specific axis going up so high, with the IMF not even coming close to projecting that the debt situation would go that high. Same sentiment when it comes to the debt in comparison to the GDP, as a percentage of the GDP. Skyrocketing effect of debt we witness, which the IMF has made no account for. Now, that is very specifically a dangerous situation, but that is not all, Mahesh. When taking that same thought process forward, we would expect when the IMF is here that the production aspect, the manufacturing aspect, the country would have grown in its GDP, would have had more potential. That is what we would expect. That is what the IMF also would have expected, but that is not what happened in reality, given the fact that the GDP of the country also dropped, a very dangerous situation. Mahesh, I believe these are some things that we should bear in mind when talking about going back to the IMF. Over to you, Mahesh.
Indeed, a lot of data there that pretty much explains exactly what happened when the IMF was last here, 2016 to 2019. One thing that people really need to understand is that even though they say that, you know, they are the solution, it's not. Dani Dutanavasam at the data wall. Thank you very much. Now, one of the biggest arguments that have been floated by the liberal clan is that, well, if you go to the IMF, it would boost investor confidence around the world, because investors would think that for some reason, if IMF is around, everything is fine. How? Think logically. Suppose there is an investor who sees a potential market in Sri Lanka. What key things would he factor in before beginning a business here? What would he get back? Will he have a higher profit margin? Is it beneficial for his company by coming into Sri Lanka? Can he actually impact his bottom line by investing here? So before he's investing, he would do the necessary study, the groundwork, about our nation, our laws, our society, our business environment, and of course, the political situation and economic history. When he finds out that apparently we went to the IMF, because you only go to the IMF when your economy is fudged up, and by that we've gone 16 times for that matter, how the heck is that going to build any confidence amongst any investor? These are the lies told by ardent bookworms who read a good book on economic theories and then flouts it to a nation in peril and sells it and themselves as the only solution. No, what they say is not the only solution. There are better solutions for Sri Lanka. We just need to be sensible enough. Our political leadership needs to be sensible enough in order to take a look at them based on rational thinking rather than fear. We will take a small break. Upon our return, more to reveal why this is the wrong choice to proceed with. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to the State of the Nation. More on the erroneous decision by the current government to seek assistance by the IMF. Something the Yahapalne jokers have been doing for 5 years, and because they applied the IMF prescription, they went home for their erroneous attempt to run the country. Listen to this lie.
ණය ගෙවීමෙන් අරමුදය විසඳන්නේ නැහැ. මොකද ණය ගෙවන තරමට සංකේත තවත් අඩු වෙනවා. ශ්‍රේණිගත වීමෙන් තවත් පහළ යනවා. දැන් IMF එකට යනවා කියන්නේ බැංකුවකට ගිහිල්ලා ණය ඉල්ලනවා වගේ. ඉතින් බිස්නස් ප්ලෑන් එකක් නැතුව ණය IMF එකට ගිහිල්ලා වැඩකුත් නැහැ. නෑ දැන් ඉක්වඩෝ කියන රට ගිය අවුරුද්දේ අප්‍රේල් මාසයේදී අපේ වගේම ප්‍රශ්නයක් තිබුණා. ශ්‍රේණිගත කිරීමෙන් CCC, ඒ කියන්නේ අපි දැන් CCC වලට වැටිලා තියෙන්නේ. ඉංග්‍රීසි ප්‍රතිවිධගත කිරීමේ සාකච්ඡාවට එළඹුණා. මාස 6න් ඒ සාකච්ඡාව ඉවර වෙලා ඉංග්‍රීසි ශ්‍රේණිගත කිරීමෙන් ඉහළ යනවා. මොකද සංක්ෂිතත් ගොඩ නැගුණා. ප්‍රශ්නය බේරුණා. ආජන්ටීනාවත් ඒකමයි කරේ. ඒගොල්ලන් ඊට වඩා විශාල මුදලක් ඩොලර් බිලියන 87ක් විතර ප්‍රතිව්‍යුහගත කරා මාස 4. මේ සාකච්ඡාව නිමා කළා රට ගොඩ ආවා.
Why I say this is a lie is pretty simple. Did you hear that part where he said, "Oh, Argentina went to the IMF, and within 6 months, everything was fixed. And they were doing very well. Here, listen again.
Argentina වත් ඒකමයි කරේ. ඒගොල්ලන් ඊට වඩා විශාල මුදලක් ඩොලර් බිලියන 87ක් විතර ප්‍රතිව්‍යුහ ගත කරා මාස 4ක්. මේ සාකච්ඡාව නිමා කළා රට ගොඩ ආවා.
All right, excellent, Mr. DeMille. So Argentina might be doing absolutely fine right now, right?
Debates about refinancing have been ongoing for 2 years, something that has caused widespread protests and frustration.
It's embarrassing. They gave away our sovereignty. Every 3 months, the IMF will come to audit our accounts. Aside from that, inflation, the costs of transport, of gas, of wheat increase every day. How are we going to afford all this?
Government says that an agreement with the IMF is crucial to stabilize the economy that is currently struggling with exchange rate controls, inflation rates, and poverty rates. But these people here say that an agreement could force the government to implement austerity measures that will have an impact in their lives.
Thousands of people in front of the presidential palace demanded the government to prioritize the people instead of the IMF.
People here are extremely concerned about the impact that the agreement will have in their lives.
This is how these liberal jokers lie to you. I mean, just imagine, this program only reaches the English-speaking audience of this nation. So you have the privilege of being aware of these bull, these goons uttered to a camera as if they have the silver bullet. With the information presented, you would have the ability to make a calculated decision to rethink when these jokers would speak again as if they were our Lord and Savior. What about the rest of the nation, especially the low-income earners who cannot look for the information, seek the truth, or understand what we are saying because of the language barrier? For them, what they see is a white-looking dude speaking in Sinhala with an English accent. Oh my, me Mahathya knows what he's talking about. Blind faith. Okay, once again, let me break down what really happened in Argentina. Argentina is a nation that has had around 22 negotiations with the IMF. In the economic world, Argentina is known as an IMF junkie. In March of 2000, the IMF agreed to a 3-year, $7.2 billion standby arrangement with Argentina, conditioned on a strict fiscal adjustment and based on the assumption of a 3.5% GDP growth in the year 2000. And that year, that was a projection, but the economy actually declined by 0.8%. IMF said it's going to grow because they gave the money. It declined in reality. In January of 2001, Argentina continued to show weak economic performance, and it prompted the IMF to top up the March 10, 2000 agreement to by $7 billion, additional $7 billion for what they gave before. It was all part of a $40 billion assistance package involving the Inter-American Development Bank, the World Bank, Spain, and private lenders. The agreement assumed GDP would grow by 2.5% in 2001, but it actually declined by 3.7%. Decline. In December of 2001, Argentina defaulted on its foreign debt. The Argentinian president at that time, Rodrigo Sá, who's just been elected by the Argentinian Congress, announced that the country is going to default on the $93 billion. That is an Argentina's sovereign debt. Rodrigo Sá also had to resign soon afterwards, thereby increasing political instability even more, as many of four different presidents tried to rule Argentina in December of 2001. Within a very small period, four presidents came to power. The Congress was electing them because nobody could do anything about their economy. They took the IMF prescription. None of them manages to remain in office. Why? Because their predecessors listened to the IMF and applied their solutions and failed. Meanwhile, later in 2018, they go back to the IMF because most South American countries are known as IMF junkies. All they do is whenever they don't have any money, IMF. In that agreement, the IMF required the government to tighten its budget by around 4.4% of the GDP from 2018 to 2020 to restore market confidence. It had the opposite effect, causing the markets to shrink. The IMF had projected positive growth of 0.4% for the year 2018 and 1.5% for the year 2019 under its program. Instead, there was a recession with GDP growth at minus 2.6%, and for 2018, a minus 2% for 2019. You can see the IMF comes with, you know, very colorful models to predict prosperity for all these countries who takes their pill. In reality, it doesn't happen. In addition, poverty increased over 50% in Argentina during that particular, the latest program. Now, when the pandemic hit, the situation worsened with GDP falling by 9.9% in 2020. In addition, an IMF internal evaluation released in December 2021 expressed unprecedented criticism of its 2018 loan agreement and conditions. IMF criticizing IMF. Right now, people are protesting in Argentina, asking the government not to go to the IMF. It's too late, they already went. Still, there is no hope. I wonder whether organizations, these think tanks like Verite Research and Advocata have a branch there, because those politicians in Argentina are begging on their knees for another bailout by the IMF. Now, looking around the world, we see a trend where people of those individual nations are selecting conservative minds to run their nation because these liberal ways of governance have failed. Even in Sri Lanka, it failed in 2019. It's sad to see that the current government, who had a good thing going, was dumping it all out due to public pressure that stemmed from an issue concerning the disruption of the supply chain. And instead of rectifying it, listening to liberal goons who have now infiltrated the finance ministry. Our real problem lies with our trade deficit, and fixing it would be the only solution. We need to not depend on the world this much. We must move away from dependency to getting from the rest of the world and make sure that they rely on us by transforming our economy into a production economy. This is what we have to do urgently. I'm now joined by renowned Sri Lankan economist, Dr. Kenneth De Silva, who knows a thing or two about economics. Thank you very much, Doctor, for joining me. Always good to see you. Now, Doctor, the current Sri Lankan government, when it came to power, the Wizards of Prosperity actually had a steady economic plan that was going in the direction to help us to stand on our two feet. Suddenly, due to shocks from the COVID pandemic, we see that the entire thing collapsing. We are resorting back to steps taken during the good governance, which we all know failed. What is the rationale to seek solutions at an institution that has failed 16 times in Sri Lanka? Please explain this to me, Doctor.
Well, Mahesh, that's a very good question to start off with. Let me first break this down into two parts. The first part, just to give you an idea of why production requires a macro framework that was proposed in the Vistas of Prosperity. And secondly, to understand why we are shifted now to an institution that we have approached 16 times and had dire results. So we'll answer those two simultaneously. So the first point being, the Vistas of Prosperity, as you rightly mentioned, looked at production economy. And the production economy predominantly focus on a gradual shift to industrialization, which has been a prerequisite for any country that's serious about lifting its GDP to about 7 to 8% growth, without which this country has no future in terms of its overall growth trajectory. So for that particular framework, you require price stability. And I think that was the key component that the government tried to anchor down. I know some of the policymakers were very serious about anchoring down price stability. And the price stability variables, two key variables were the exchange rate and also the interest rate. So if you look at the Vistas of Prosperity, you will see that it mentioned that there was going to be a stable or predictable exchange rate environment and also single digit interest rates. Now, those two have a much deeper policy framework beneath it, and to enable that, there was a lot of policy actions that were put in place to ensure that inflation story remained consistent, and as a result of that consistency, inflation remained low. And as a result of inflation remaining low, we saw inflation actually averaging around 4.5% to 5%. And as a result of that particular environment, you found interest rate stability coming across the board, right down to the long-term interest rate curve. So that was useful, and I think the benefit of that particular low interest rate regime was felt and absorbed by the business community. We saw people getting back into investment and investment activity gradually picking up, and that was a good sign for Sri Lanka's overall production and industrialization journey. The exchange rate also is similar requirement, because when you have exchange rate volatility, that volatility has to be passed through into various goods and services, and in turn inflation also it tends to pick up, because Sri Lanka does import quite a bit of inelastic goods into this country. And therefore, any movement in exchange rates or excessive volatility in exchange rates causes the overall misalignment in the macro variables, and also brings about a much more serious impact into the real economy, because prices have to be readjusted. So those two variables were the key focus, and I think a lot of policy measures are put in place to address that. Yes, we had a situation where it was not foretold and planned, as it were, in terms of what happened with COVID. Many expected COVID to be a short term or very short period where economies will be impacted, but it didn't turn out to be that. It spread across about a year, and we found economies closing down their borders, and even as a result of that, the tourism sector was impacted, and that tourism sector is a key component of your overall national cash flows. And when you lose about $3.5 billion, you have to work on contingency plans. And now, as a result of those contingency plans, there were a series of other policy actions put in place to look at how best you can manage your overall balance of payments, particularly the trade account deficit and the overall current account. And I think that was where the deviation took place in some of the overall thinking process. And as a result of that deviation, we found ourselves going back to the IMF in terms of how we are going to adjust the overall economy as a result of this cash flow shortfall. So the IMF, as you rightly pointed out, is no solution to this. There is a solution on the table. I think people should have really looked at that solution, because this solution was tabled at many forums, and many policy makers were given these solutions. It was a question of them acting on this, but I think they had a bit of reluctancy to act on it, and as a result of that delay in the process, we had no other option but I think now looking at an alternative way to fund this imbalance in the overall balance of payments. Now, lastly, I want to tell you that the point that people talk about in terms of bringing the IMF and there was no solution is not true. There is always other options as opposed to seeking the IMF. And I think some of the options, I myself have been coming to media and saying this, that there are bilateral arrangements, because our bilateral external debt book is much more greater than the short-term commercial debt, and that bilateral arrangement need to be pursued vigorously if you have to come out of this, and that was a possibility. And I think that needed some leadership to take place. And if that happened, I think this particular move towards IMF could have been withstood and also could have been prevented. And I think I'm happy to see that some of the bilateral agreements have been revisited and there is discussion around it. But I think that's a little too late now, because we are already committed to the IMF program. I was told that yesterday there was a draft agreement in place. So I think we are gone in a little too deep to turn back and reverse the course that we are currently in.
What you say is absolutely right, Doctor. Now, if you were advising the current finance minister or the present government, and if the goal is to get out of this crisis and not fall for another crisis, what should Sri Lanka do at this time, in your opinion?
Good question again. Well, I mean, we've been discussing this with, as I told you, many policymakers. I think if you look at the trade imbalance itself over the last decade or so, you'll find four main countries account for about 50% of our overall trade, namely India, China, Singapore, and the UAE. It's in their interest to see that Sri Lanka continues to engage in trade and the vibrancy of trade continues. So I think we should have and still could have approached these countries and looked at more bilateral arrangements via the trade credits. There can be a structured loan in place. There can be many other off-balance sheet guarantees that could come in place where Sri Lanka could access capital via these off-balance sheet guarantees. Some of it is there, some of it is still possible. So there are many options on the table. I mean, I'm sad to say that we have probably overlooked those options and gone with a more familiar option, which has been the IMF. And remember that IMF has been here in Sri Lanka not too late, not in the distant past. If you look at it, 2016, IMF was here. That same prescription has been resubmitted to Sri Lanka to follow. And if you look at what happened in 2016 to 2019, those results speak for itself. If you look at the IMF projections, those projections have never materialized. You all should revisit it and see what the IMF has projected for Sri Lanka and where is it now. And when you backtest it and see what has happened, you see that the IMF has not done any significant good for this country. So that's why I have been advocating to leave the IMF path away from Sri Lanka. It is a path that has not brought any positive results since 1965. And it's shocking to see that people are still advocating, and many in Sri Lanka are advocating some dire prescriptions on top of the IMF prescriptions, like debt restructuring, which is really utterly dangerous for Sri Lanka.
Makes perfect sense. Clarity is what's really required. All right, thank you very much, renowned Sri Lankan economist Dr. Kenneth De Silva. Appreciate it, as always. Let's wrap up this program tonight. As a country on the precipice of another disaster, we have to be prudent about what we do next. Just because the cows moo or the monkey starts dancing, or even because self-proclaimed economic gurus who knows that they are bullshitting and yet continues to do so just to get again a political mileage screams, it doesn't mean that our leaders of this nation must take ad hoc decisions to change the course of everything. Yes, we need to tweak and react to what's occurring right now, beyond our control, that is, and ensure that we continue on a beneficial path for this country. Returning to failed policies of the Yahapalani joke is not the solution. But unfortunately, it looks like the leaders of this nation has lost faith in their own vistas of prosperity and acting as if their opponent's vision is the best. Considering all that, the state of our nation is troubling and needs a course correction soon. I hope the leaders will wake up. That's all the time we have for you tonight. If you couldn't catch this program live, please watch it on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/otherderanaenglish. I'm Mahieash Johnney. Remember to stay positive, test negative. I'll see you soon. Good night.